Macmillan Audio presents 24, Life Stories and Lessons from the Say Hey Kid. Written by Willie Mays and John Shea, with a foreword written by Bob Costas. Read by Larry Herron, Julian McWilliams, and Bob Costas.
Hi, this is Bob Costas, and when Willie Mays and John Shea asked me to write the foreword for this book, I was more than pleased to oblige. So here we go. 660 career home runs, 250 home run seasons, 12 gold gloves. A glance at Willie Mays' page on Baseball Reference reveals he led the league in one significant category or another 37 times. 37. And yet, none of that tells the whole story. Not even close. Impressive as they are, mere numbers could never do Willie Mays full justice. Numbers are cold. They're instructive, but with few exceptions, not evocative. How do you quantify the qualities of legend and romance? What's the metric for presence, charisma, and flair? How do you explain the intangible qualities that elevate craftsmanship to art, excellence to true greatness? It's been nearly half a century since Willie Mays hung him up, more than that since he was in his prime. Yet for those who saw him play, the memory does not fade. His place in the imagination is permanent. The startlingly spectacular plays, the rush of excitement that filled the ballpark as Willie turned a double into a triple, his hat flying off as he rounded second. The way even the routine became distinctive. The basket catch at the hip, turning easy fly balls into personal signatures. I always believed that if you took a non-fan to a Giants game, someone who didn't know a sacrifice fly from a squeeze play, he or she would naturally turn their attention to Willie. Whether climbing the wall for an impossible grab, or just walking from the on-deck circle to the plate, the spotlight followed him. A strong case can be made for Willie Mays as the greatest all-round player in baseball history. An equally strong case can be made for him as baseball's most entertaining player. He could do what others only dreamed of doing, and do it with a childlike joy everyone could feel and relate to. It's a cliche to say, you had to be there, or you had to have seen it to understand. But in Willie's case, it's absolutely true. He was so compelling, so distinctive, so flat-out wondrous that, well, you really did have to be there. I'm lucky enough to be able to say I was. My first memory of the Say Hey Kid dates to 1957, the Giants' last season in New York. I'm 5 years old, and my dad takes me to the polo grounds. We're in the grandstand down the right field line. I don't remember any of the game's particulars. It's all atmospherics. The vivid colors of the playing field, a revelation when baseball previously had only come to me through the radio or in flickering images on a black and white TV. The buzz of the crowd, the swirling cigar smoke, the beer here and get your scorecard refrains of the vendors. And this, I'm perched on my dad's shoulders, dazzled by the panorama of sights and sounds. The Giants are in the field when my dad says, "Look, Bobby, look at the player standing way out there in center field. No, not that guy. The one in the middle. That's Willie Mays." It was as if he were pointing out the Statue of Liberty or the Empire State Building. As if he were saying, "Take note, son, that's Willie Mays. You won't forget the first time you saw him." More than 60 years later, it's still true. Decades later, Willie and I would become friends. I would interview him many times. He'd cheerfully acknowledge that he purposely chose a cap a half size too small so it would fly off as he sped around the bases or across the outfield. You have got to entertain the people. Willie is a natural storyteller, his high-pitched voice rising in volume as a favorite anecdote reaches its payoff. But all the natural enthusiasm, all the innate grace, shouldn't obscure the fact that Willie's baseball IQ was phenomenal. He routinely repositioned the fielders around him and seldom, if ever, took his cue from the third base coach. His own sense of how a play would develop was all he needed. Tim McCarver once told me that in a meeting before any series with the Giants, Cardinals manager Johnny Keene would remind his team that with the exception of the ninth inning or extra innings, with Mays on base and trying to score on a base hit, never throw to the plate. Why? Because Mays was so smart, so aware, that he would purposely make the play appear close enough to draw the throw, but he would always be safe. Meanwhile, the trail runner or runners would take the extra base. In 2006 on HBO, I asked him about Game 7 of the 1962 World Series at Candlestick Park. Yankees won, Giants nothing. Two out, bottom of the ninth. Matty Alou at first, Willie at the plate. He sent an opposite field double down the right field line. Roger Maris cut it off before the warning track, and Alou was stopped at third, after which Willie McCovey lined out to end the series. Willie's recollection of every part of the game was spot on, and here he grew emphatic. If I had been the runner instead of the hitter, there wouldn't have been a stop sign, and if there was, I'd have run through it. Either I score or I make them make a perfect play to get me. One of the best broadcasting experiences I've ever had came a few years later when Willie and Hank Aaron joined me for an hour-long conversation before a theater audience. The two greatest living players reveling in each other's company, the rivalry having mellowed into a deeper friendship and mutual appreciation. The stories overflowed, just as they do in this very welcoming book. Willie Mays has been the subject of multiple biographies, documentaries, and print and broadcast appreciations. But Willie and John Shea have found a fresh way in, and here's how. 24 chapters, each illuminating a chapter of Willie's remarkable career and life. Baseball history, the Giant-Dodger rivalry, through the eyes of those who lived it. Social history, Willie on his time in the Negro Leagues, and his relationship with Barack Obama. Personal history, the influence of Willie's baseball-savvy dad. And new perspectives, including those of today's premier center fielder, Mike Trout, born in 1991, but destined to be part of the same conversations as Willie for decades to come. Entire chapters are devoted to Willie's four-homer game in Milwaukee, and the 16-inning duel between Juan Marichal and Warren Spahn in 1963, scoreless until Willie homered off Spahn to win it. And of course, the 1954 back-to-the-plate World Series robbery of Vic Wirtz, the most famous catch in baseball history. Even if, like me, you thought you had pretty much read and heard all there was to read and hear about Willie Mays, this warm-hearted book will inform and reward you. And besides, what true baseball fan can ever get enough of Willie Mays? Say hey, listen on, and enjoy.
Chapter 1. Set an example. The story of 24.
People judge you all kinds of ways. Let them say what they want. Be your own judge. Trust your heart.
Willie Mays. Willie Mays was 26 years old and the most exciting player in baseball when the Giants moved from New York to their new home in 1958. San Francisco, however, was Joe DiMaggio's town. DiMaggio was a native son born to Sicilian immigrants who settled in the fishing community of Martinez before relocating across the bay to San Francisco's North Beach neighborhood where young Joe and his brothers played ball in the sand lots. After emerging as a local legend with the San Francisco Seals of the old Pacific Coast League, especially amid his 61-game hit streak as an 18-year-old in 1933, DiMaggio became a New York Yankee. The heir to Babe Ruth, and hit in 56 straight games and won 9 World Series. He played through 1951, the year Mays broke into the big leagues. After the Giants arrived in San Francisco, DiMaggio's celebrity didn't vanish. Some locals welcomed the team, but were unconvinced of Mays, who had earned his claim to fame in New York. That Mays played DiMaggio's position in DiMaggio's ballpark in DiMaggio's town made it difficult to be accepted at first.
They didn't know me. At that time, I felt they still wanted Joe to shine. He was from San Francisco and went on to play for the Yankees. They thought nobody else could play center field except him. That's what I got out of it. I think sometimes they wanted somebody else to be the leader of the ball club.
Mays was learning what Mickey Mantle had gone through in New York. Following the great DiMaggio is no easy task. But unlike Mantle, who was DiMaggio's immediate successor on the Yankees, Mays appeared in San Francisco 23 years after DiMaggio last played for the Seals. Still, a full generation later, Mays took the Seals stadium field and wasn't fully appreciated. As wacky as it now seems, there were boos. Not always, not rampant, not consistent, but boos nonetheless. There were media criticisms, not because he wasn't fantastic, not because he wasn't the best player on the field, but because he wasn't DiMaggio, because he was the face of the franchise that displaced the beloved Seals, because there was hesitation to immediately adopt a New York star, because, at least for some, of his skin color. And also because of Orlando Cepeda and other young players emerging from a rich and diverse minor league system.
"Well, it's because they built him so high," said Cepeda, who was named the National League's top rookie with the 1958 Giants. "San Francisco had been a AAA town, not a big league town. They had never seen Willie play every day. But when they saw Willie play every day and saw him do the things he could do on the field, things changed. Because the things Willie did on the field in those days, nobody else did. Still, today, I don't see players doing what Willie did."
Cepeda was the toast of San Francisco, having never played with the Giants in New York. He was 20 years old when breaking in, just like Willie. It was a strange dynamic, not everyone quick to embrace Mays, but most cynics eventually came to their senses and welcomed his one-of-a-kind talent. Cynics who didn't were ignored as contrarians who simply wanted attention. Or worse. Race was a factor, of course. Before his first season in San Francisco, Mays and his wife tried to buy a house in an upscale San Francisco neighborhood and were denied because they were African American. After a storm of publicity and intervention from the mayor, they eventually bought the house, but a year and a half later, someone threw a bottle through the front window with a hate note inside. Apparently, it was okay for the great Mays to tirelessly represent the city and region and delight thousands of fans every night, so long as he didn't live in certain people's neighborhoods. That was 1958 when he came to San Francisco, and 1958 was 1958. "We're past some things. We're not past everything," said Hall of Famer Joe Morgan, who grew up in Oakland and whose father took him to Giants games in those early years. There were some writers who were critical and didn't want to give Mays his due because he was from New York. "I didn't see DiMaggio play, but he was the golden boy of San Francisco." You've got to remember that. For a lot of people, Mays was the guy who was taking his spot. Mays didn't see it that way. He had nothing against DiMaggio. In fact, as a kid growing up in Alabama, he idolized DiMaggio and wanted to emulate his all-around game.
"I looked up to Stan Musial, Ted Williams, and Joe DiMaggio. I read about them in the papers. They were on the front page all the time, all over the headlines. Stan the man, the splendid splinter, Jolting Joe, great outfielders, great ball players. This was before Jackie Robinson. I liked Joe and wanted to be like Joe, a guy who could do everything on a baseball field. When I came out west in 58, they always talked about Joe being the San Francisco guy. There was no other center fielder except Joe. I didn't say anything or let it bother me. I just moved on and played. They didn't know that Joe was my guy, too. In the 51 World Series, he hit a home run, and I'm out there in center field clapping. I don't remember doing too many things wrong, But what am I doing out there clapping for this man? I had to catch myself. I always wondered why nobody took that picture.
Over time, most, if not all, of San Francisco warmed to Mays, and why not? He no longer was in a New York uniform or playing home games in the polo grounds. He was in his prime and fully dedicated to San Francisco, where he lived year-round and was active in the community. He was inspiring a game, a nation, and many a generation, and being called the greatest all-around player in the history of baseball, an American icon, a treasure, a hero. What's not to love? Beyond the on-field athletic brilliance, no one was more gifted in so many areas or played with such artistic swagger. Mays, a major leaguer just 4 years after Robinson broke the color barrier, was known for his personal strength and integrity. While sports in general, and baseball in particular, have been plagued by scandals over the years, Mays' story is honorably refreshing. He gives his life to charitable causes, especially involving children and public safety, as a philanthropist through his Say Hey Foundation and other avenues, a calling that dates to his playing days. In 1971, he was the first recipient of what became known as the Roberto Clemente Award, a prestigious philanthropic honor named after the great ball player who died in a plane crash trying to aid victims of a Nicaragua earthquake. I didn't dream about being president. I dreamed about being Willie Mays until I realized I couldn't hit. The presidency thing was the farthest thing from my mind. Being a ball player wasn't, said former President George W. Bush, who grew up in a baseball family and owned the Texas Rangers before becoming governor of Texas and then president. I was an aspiring young kid. I collected baseball cards. I was just a baseball guy. I love the game. Still do. When friends of mine and I bought the Rangers, it was like living the dream to be involved with Major League Baseball at that level. So Willie, in many ways, cemented my love of baseball. He was aspirational for me. I didn't know much about him other than the fact that he was a great baseball player. And to think he came out of Alabama and battled his way through the segregation era and went into the Army— he's a man of remarkable talents, but also remarkable drive. Bush was born in the summer of 1946, as was former President Bill Clinton, the first two baby boomer presidents, both with an early love and appreciation for baseball, and both captivated by Mays, an immensely popular celebrity among the first generation that emerged after World War II. The country turned its attention to leisurely activities just as the golden age of baseball arrived, and Mays was at the forefront, not just as the game's premier overall player, but the most entertaining. I loved watching Stan Musial and the Cardinals, and I liked the Brooklyn Dodgers because of Jackie Robinson. They had a great roster in the 50s, said Clinton, who grew up in Arkansas listening to Harry Carey calling Cardinals games. But my favorite player from the beginning was Willie Mays. He played with so much joy, and he had so many skills. I just liked him. He could do everything well. The polo grounds was a tough place to play baseball because it was so deep to center field, but the way he ran around out there was something to behold. Mays' cumulative accomplishments are unparalleled. 660 home runs, 3,283 hits, 338 stolen bases, 12 straight Gold Glove awards, 24 All-Star Game appearances, as well as his five-tool proficiency, hitting for average and power, fielding, throwing, and base running. Perhaps more than any player in history, a case can be made that any one of Mays' tools is as elite as the next. He runs as well as he hits, as well as he defends. There's no clear answer as to which is his best tool, or worst, for that matter. Snapshot moments include the basket catch that he perfected in the Army, the cap flying off his head as he raced from first to third, the World Series catch shown for eternity in black and white, the four home run day at Hank Aaron's Park in Milwaukee, the 16th inning homer to beat Warren Spahn 1-0, and the 8th inning homer in the 1962 finale that led to a playoff with the Dodgers. Generations have admired Mays' ability and determination along the way.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.